Well, year to date, the Indian markets are flattish, but the mid-cap and the small-cap indices, they have lost between 15% to around 20%, making the bottom-up investment approach rather challenging and interesting. Joining me today on the show is founder and managing partner at Pabrai Investment Funds, Mr. Mohnish Pabrai. Thanks so much, Mohnish, for coming down and speaking to us here at CNBC TV 18. Well, you know, let's start off. There's so much of pessimism, so many headwinds we're talking about, from rising crude oil prices to slowing global growth concerns. What are you doing as of now? What would you tell our viewers out there? Bury your head in the sand or go out there and deploy some money?
Well, Nigel, first of all, always a pleasure to hang out with you. And congratulations on becoming a new dad.
Thanks so
much. And you look pretty good for a guy who doesn't sleep at night.
Thanks so much.
Well, you know, I think the thing is that, you know, Ben Graham, one of his three core edicts that Buffett talks about is that the market is here to serve us, mm-hmm. not to instruct us.
Right.
And so we should never be trying to kind of look for rationality mm-hmm. in market levels or market prices.
Okay.
What we have to do as investors is effectively forget the market, but look at individual businesses.
Yeah.
When they're being offered at bargain basement prices, we buy.
Mm-hmm.
And when they're being sold at ridiculously high prices, we sell.
Yeah.
And that's pretty much it. And we don't particularly care about what's happening with Brent or what's happening with growth or what's happening with an NBFC. All of those are in the noise range. We really don't care about those things.
Oh, that's quite interesting, because there's been so much of noise and so much of headwinds that we have been talking about. Simple point, are you deploying money out of your total size of money that you're investing? I think you manage around $800 million approximately. How much of that is allocated to India? And are you buying, most importantly?
In fact, we bought today. We bought some sizable chunks.
Mm-hmm.
And we're buying every day. And I think out of the 800, about half, mm-hmm. roughly about half is in India. And that number has been inching upwards for the last several years.
Okay, so you're definitely buying into this correction, you know, deploying money into the Indian markets
yeah,
as well.
Yeah, and again, like I said, I don't particularly care about corrections and such. I think in general, when we have situations like we have currently, a number of businesses go on sale.
Okay.
And as long as an investor can understand the businesses, it's within his or her circle of competence, and can buy them well below what they're worth,
mm-hmm.
that's the name of the game. You should be buying at that point and ignore the noise.
Well, you're sitting away in California, but you relate to your roots, to India, and you relate the markets to Mahabharata. I believe that you derive some inspiration from Arjun focusing on the target. Is that something you're looking at?
That's right. So
explain that to us.
Well, we all know the story in the Mahabharata about Arjun and Dronacharya, and he has this test where he has to shoot the eye of the fish looking at the reflection
yeah.
in the pool of water. We all know that. And when Arjun is asked by Dronacharya, what do you see? He says, I see only the center of the center mm. of the eye of the fish.
Yeah.
And Dronacharya says, you know, fire at will. And of course, he shoots the eye out. And so the direct analogy there is when we are looking at a specific business and we're looking at the future prospects of a business, we really shouldn't deviate or take our focus away from that mm. into anything else that's going on.
Okay.
So I'll give you a very, very simple example. So when we had the unfortunate incidents of 9/11, you know, when the Twin Towers went down and so on, U.S. markets imploded
yeah.
after that. One particular company in the U.S. called Stewart Enterprises
okay.
also went down, like everything else.
Right.
Stewart Enterprises buries dead people. Did the prospects of Stewart Enterprises suddenly deteriorate
mm-hmm.
after 9/11? If people were concerned that there were going to be more airplanes flying into more towers,
mm-hmm.
as morbid as it sounds, their business would have boomed.
Yeah.
And so there was no rational reason. I mean, United Airlines should have gone down.
Yeah.
American Airlines should have gone down. Stewart Enterprises should have gone up.
Right.
It didn't go up. Mm-hmm. It went down as well. And so markets gyrate between fear and greed, and they have a lot of irrationality. Our job as investors is not to try to give reason to the irrationality. It's to take advantage of irrationality.
Okay. You know, in India, it's perceived that real estate was a safe investment. Every Indian out there, they want to go out and own their own home. And that's why real estate has been a play. Now, for one, you have been fairly positive on the real estate space. Just looking by your holdings, you know, you have a large chunk in Suntech Realty, in Kolte Patil as well, you have a large chunk, and also in Repco Home Finance. So how do you see the real estate space playing out in India? Is it an opportunity with the kind of correction we have seen on a lot of these real estate stocks, as well as some of these, you know, home lenders?
Yeah, I think Pabrai funds will do extremely well. Mm-hmm. And make a lot of hay off our real estate bets.
Yeah.
And the reason is very simple, that the market or investors really don't understand how to properly value real estate companies.
Okay.
So the way a real estate company ought to be valued is, and it's not that hard, most real estate companies are pretty transparent about their holdings, about their debt, and so you can come up with some kind of market pricing on the holdings.
Okay.
You can subtract the debt and you get an asset value. You can even discount that in case prices drop and so on.
Yeah.
So that gives you what I would call the liquidation value of a given real estate company.
Okay.
Most of these companies that I'm invested in trade at a substantial discount to liquidation,
okay,
which means if they shut down their business today and sold their assets, we'd get a multiple of what the stock trades at, even in today's market. But but that's not the way to value the business. That's one aspect of the business.
Okay.
The more important aspect of the business is these companies are factories. And the factories are not physical plants, they're virtual plants.
Okay.
And the factories have the ability to keep making deals, keep cranking out more finished product, and continue on. And so just like with Maruti, when we value Maruti, we look at the next 10 or 15 years of revenues and growth Maruti we have. The same thing we need to do with real estate companies.
Yeah.
We have to look at what are they possibly able to do in the next 10 or 15 years.
Yeah.
And so one of the things that's happened in real estate is that because of RERA, GST, demonetization, all of these things, 80 to 90% of real estate companies are either gone or on life support, and they will be gone. So if I'm participating in an industry where 9 out of 10 of my competitors are gone, that's a phenomenal place to be.
Yeah.
And so I think that the companies that we have, we bought them well below liquidation, but that's not really where the game's at. The game is about what they do in the next 10 or 20 years.
All right.
And if I look at a place like Mumbai, because specifically I'm interested in real estate in Mumbai, it is one of the only places in the world where people live in very expensive housing, which is terrible. The housing stock in this city is terrible. And in fact, if I take a 30-year or 50-year view, almost the entire city will be torn down and rebuilt. And the torn down and rebuilding that's going to happen, we're down to about 20 players.
Okay.
And so that, just think about the size of that.
Yeah.
And it's very hard for new entrants. The other thing, if you go on Wikipedia and look at, you know, most populated cities in the world, let's say in 2050, number one on that list is Mumbai. And I know we think that too many people here today.
Yeah.
In 2050, we're looking at north of 50 million.
So clearly, you're bullish on the real estate space. You also made a reference to Maruti. So I wanted to take both those two points forward.
Sure.
One is, what's your view on the automobile space in India? Are you investing out there? It's a known fact that Pabrai Investments has a large chunk in out of your total funds in Fiat.
Yeah.
So in terms of the auto space, what's your view? Do you think, are you bullish on the auto space in India? And also the second part, what about Repco Home Finance? That's another company where you have a large chunk. Real estate, you're bullish on, but some of these home finance lenders, they're going to be, you know, there's a lot of competition out there. You have liquidity that's drying up as well. So give us your take on both these two.
Yeah, so actually, as far as the auto industry goes, I hate the auto industry. I think it's a terrible industry.
But you have a big chunk in Fiat.
Yeah, so in 2012 is when we first invested in Fiat. And from 2012 till now, Fiat has delivered, it's about 6 or 7x now. At the peak, it was about 8 or 9x.
Okay.
So it's done really well. But we bought it basically at one times 2018 earnings. So in 2012, we were buying at one time 2018 earnings, and that actually came to pass.
Okay.
And so we were buying a company with $150 billion in revenue mm-hmm. at a $5 billion market cap. I paid 1/30th okay. of revenue. So one simple thing you can look up for Maruti after the show, look at the market cap, I think it's something like $20 billion, mm-hmm. and look at the revenue of the company. It's the complete opposite of Fiat. So Maruti is very dominant, phenomenal business.
Yeah.
Investing is not about identifying great assets.
Okay.
That's only one part of the equation. We have to identify great assets at great prices. And to me, Maruti is a great asset, but it is nowhere near a great price.
Okay, all right. And what about Repco Home Finance, the housing finance space on the whole?
So, you know, we are not into stock tips, Nigel.
Yeah.
But I would just say that I think Repco is a very different DNA than the India Bulls or Divan Housing and let's say the high testosterone NBFCs. And also they serve a market where they have almost no competition. So they're in a ticket size of like 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs. They're into rural areas or tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 towns. And so a lot of similarities to Gru Finance.
Right.
And so it's a so I don't think you can paint all the housing finance companies, all the NBFCs with the same brush. They're all different. This is an interesting business. It serves a demographic that is very underserved. And so that's what interested me.
All right. It's been a pleasure talking to you, Mr. Pabrai. Thanks so much for coming down to our studio. Always good to speak to you. Well, on that note, we'll wrap up on the show. Thanks so much for watching. That's Mr. Mohnish Pabrai telling us he's definitely investing in the Indian markets. He's definitely bullish going ahead as well. And he says it's not the time to bury your head in the sand. Thanks so much for watching.